And I will now call to order the Planning Board meeting of January 17, 2006. The first item on our agenda is a review of the minutes of our prior meeting from December 20th, 2005. Are there any comments or corrections from any members of the board? Barbara?
Well, I can't really make a correction is the problem, but John Chiraldo's comments were left out of the minutes, and I really thought we should have included it. I thought they were very important.
I thought in reviewing these that there was a reference to the issue of accessing the development through a lot in an existing subdivision.
Yeah, but I thought what he said and the way he said it, and I cannot paraphrase what he said, was very relevant and well said. So I thought it should be a little bit more explicit.
Let me see if I can find it, Barbara. Okay, I mean, I certainly do remember John Chiraldo's comments, Barbara, and what we could do is leave this, the approval of these minutes open till the next hearing and add a bit more regarding John's comments and then approve them at that time.
If there is a tape, is there not, of the minutes? And I think that would be the best place because I cannot say what he said, but I know that it was very relevant what he said.
I agree.
Okay, is that acceptable to the board if we table the approval of these minutes until the next regular hearing, which would be the end of February? Okay, thanks. Were there any other comments, though, other than that? Okay. Correspondence that we've received prior to tonight's meeting is a memorandum from the town manager regarding Spurwink Woods, a letter from P. Heffenreffer and M. Marshall regarding 349 Ocean House Road, the bisected lots recommendation to the town council from the planning board, a memorandum from Chief McGoldrick regarding Spurwink Woods, the zoning practice, November 2005 issue, building permit issuance data, and tonight we have also received a letter dated January 15, 2006 from Deborah Vallely regarding Spurwink Woods, an email from Sharon O'Neill and Tim O'Neill of 56 Columbus Road regarding Spurwink Woods, a letter from Richard Bryant and Jean Najemi dated January 17, 2006 regarding Spurwink Woods, a memorandum from the Conservation Commission to the Planning Board dated January 17, 2006 regarding the sewer rehab pump station, and a letter dated January 16, 2006 to the Planning Board regarding the proposed Cape Commerce Center and the potential tenant Dunkin' Donuts from Jan Messerschmidt. And finally, there is a handwritten letter from Suzanne and Tom Higgins. Oh, thank you. Regarding the item on the agenda that has been withdrawn. In fact, the original agenda for tonight's meeting included as a consent agenda item the Conley Higgins Resource Protection Permit. If anybody came for that particular issue, that has been withdrawn, so it will not be considered tonight. We have, under old business, the Spurwink Woods subdivision, there was a suggestion that we take things out of order on the agenda tonight and deal first with the Tall Pine Sewer Pump Station, as that will likely be a shorter presentation. Does that sound like a reasonable plan?
Yep, great idea.
Do we have a motion?
Motion to reshuffle the agenda, Mr. Chairman.
Motion's been made?
Second. Motion.
And seconded. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. So we would ask the applicant, which is the town of Cape Elizabeth, to come to the podium. They are requesting site plan review and a resource protection permit to construct a new pump station as part of sewer rehabilitation work in the area of Ocean House Road and Maple Lane, Section 19-9, Site Plan Completeness, and Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the board for allowing us to go first. I appreciate it. We have before you a project that we discussed with you at the workshop. It's a new pump station to go as part of the overall sewer rehabilitation project that we'll be hopefully undertaking this summer. Just briefly to orient you to the drawing, we have Ocean House Road right here, and then currently we have a gravity line that feeds down the hill and then goes cross-country to another pump station that is located off this drawing. Basically, what we found is that over time, this gravity line that went originally through this very wet area has settled in different areas and created low spots, which has caused some problems for some houses located off the drawing to the feet of the south, and they've actually had some backups there. We studied the area. Initially, we thought we'd just come in and do another gravity system, make it a better base coming across here. But the soils are very, very soft in here. We had a geotechnical study done. They did borings. We found that there's a peat with very soft clays under there. So to redo this line, put a new gravity line in, we'd have to spend a lot of money, and we still wouldn't get the peace of mind that we've actually solved the problem in the long term. So what we've come up with is a pump station design here where we'd accept the flow coming down the hill and feed a force main through the existing gravity line to the terminus manhole, which is the end of Tall Pine. In doing that, we would get the flow to go through here under a pressure system. We'd be less susceptible, less limited by the actual elevations through here, which are very flat. In order to serve these two lines, which currently gravity drain into the main line here, we'd run another sewer system along Ocean House Road and come out the fronts of those houses into that gravity system that would also drain into this pump station. We've got a few storm drain pipes in here that we're going to have to relocate in order to make this work. We've got a small driveway access in through here that would allow the Portland Water District to back in and access and maintain the pump station, which they will actually, they maintain all the pump stations for the town of Cape Elizabeth under the current agreement. We have some landscaping that we're showing around the building, around the pump station. It's a mixture of shrubs and plants and trees, not trying to screen or block the pump station, but just kind of soften its view. You wouldn't really see much as you come down here. There's a low profile, probably the top of the pump station you would see. There's another smaller basin that you would see the top of as well. It's a wet well. There'll be a control panel that you would see in a small, almost looks like an old TV antenna, which would be the telemetry system that would be involved in that. Basically, we needed to come before you today because we have a resource protection permit, an RP1 wetland, which is the edge of which is shown in this blue. There's also edges of the wetlands up above here. And that's about it. We are asking for several waivers that we discussed in the workshop. We're asking for a waiver of the high intensity soil mapping. We're asking for a waiver of the high intensity soil mapping. We're also asking for a waiver of the written description of the entire parcel, location of the site wetlands. The parcels are owned by the town. It's actually part of the Lions Field parcel on this edge, and then there's a parcel that's on the end of Tall Pine that's also owned by the town. We're also asking for a waiver of stormwater runoff calculations. There's very little surface change associated with this, very little grading change as well. And I believe that was it. Feel free to answer any questions you may have.
All right, thank you. The first order of business for this applicant is completeness. And I believe at our planning board workshop, we indicated a willingness to agree to those three waivers. So it would seem that a motion would be in order on that issue. unless anybody has any questions. Barbara?
Happy to make a motion.
Okay.
Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit to construct a pump station and rehabilitate existing sewer lines within 250 feet of RP1 wetlands located in the area of Route 77 and Maple Lane be deemed complete.
Barbara has made the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
And it has been seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Yeah, the motion carries. At this point, we need to decide whether a site walk or public hearing is going to be necessary, and I'm wondering if we have received any comments from any of the abutters or any members of the public.
I haven't heard anything from anyone.
Anybody want to weigh in on that, John?
There's no digging involved here, right? It's just running a second pipe through there.
There will be digging involved with the excavation for the pump station, and there will also be digging involved with relocation of the storm drain. What we're hoping to do is feed a force main through the existing gravity line, fuse it together, and make that connection that way. So there wouldn't be any digging through this area.
Is there anyone here this evening to speak on this?
That's a good question. Is anybody here to speak on this particular application that wishes to be heard? Did we actually schedule a public hearing for tonight? We did not.
Nope.
Okay. What is the board's thoughts on whether we'd be prepared to approve this tonight or whether we need a public hearing? Barbara?
Prepared.
Ready to move forward? Seems like it would be appropriate.
Yep.
Is there a motion? Paul?
Motion for approval, Mr. Chairman. Findings of fact, one, the Town of Cape Elizabeth is requesting a resource protection permit to construct a pump station and rehabilitate existing sewer lines within 250 feet of RP1 wetlands located in the area of Route 77 and Maple Lane, which requires review under Section 19-8-3 Wetlands Regulations. Two, the application substantially complies with Section 19-8-3, the Wetland Regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a resource protection permit to construct a pump station and rehabilitate existing sewer lines within 250 feet of RP1 wetlands located in the area of Route 77 and Maple Lane be approved.
A motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? The motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
It was seconded by Barbara, correct? Can you second the motion? The next item on the agenda is the Spurwink Woods Preliminary Subdivision Review and Resource Protection Permit. Spurwink Woods LLC is requesting preliminary subdivision review and a resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, a 43-unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Clearview Road. The application includes 19 condominiums and 23 single-family home lots on 24.97 acres. The comments of the town engineer are attached. The application will be reviewed this evening for compliance with Section 16-2-4 Subdivision Regulations and Section 19-8-3 Resource Protection Regulations. Before we ask the applicant to come forward and summarize any changes since the last time they were here, we just had a couple of issues to deal with. One is we do have a new member of the Planning Board, John Siegfried. Welcome.
Thank you.
And John, did you have a comment that you wanted to make for the record this evening?
Yes, I'd like to state for the record that I have reviewed the whole, these meetings are recorded, so I reviewed the whole December 20th from start to finish meeting that was held prior to the holidays. So, and I have all the correspondence from the middle of 2005, and I've read up. So I feel sorry.
Did you also have an opportunity to walk the site with the town planner?
Yes, and I walked the site with Barbara and with the town planner.
Okay, great, thank you. A suggestion was made, oh, yes, Barbara.
I'd like to put something on record, too. I'd like on record that I have in great detail read all the many letters that have been written, that I walked the site walk a second time with John and with Jack Keneally when there was no snow on the ground so that we could see some of the pools of water and some of the wetlands, and that I have driven Mitchell Road at least 5 or 6 times, as well as the abutting roads, Kildare, and have driven South Street and Stevenson, and I'd like that all to be put in the record. Thank you.
Does anybody else wish to make any further comments before we get further into the application? A suggestion was made by one of the abutters, I believe, that we, in order to make this process perhaps more comprehensible for everyone, including the planning board, but also people who are interested in following the project, that we try to take issues one at a time, and then we would hear from the applicant on, say, stormwater management, then we would open it up to questions and try to get through that issue as comprehensively as possible, then move on to the next issue. And a number of issues were outlined in the town planner's memorandum, and unless the board members have other suggestions, it seems to me it would make sense to try to take issues one at a time. Is that agreeable to the board? But John, I don't know if the applicant wants to make some sort of overall presentation first. I don't know what you really had in mind tonight, so I don't want to catch you off guard. But does that general approach sound okay with you?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
It is.
Oh, yes. And the town planner did remind me we are not going to be discussing the issue of traffic tonight. That will be on the agenda for the February 27th public hearing. I'm sorry, public meeting. Paul.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a question regarding, I guess, our process. Knowing that tonight and that in the February public meeting, we will be getting new material presented to us relative to changes to the plans, what will be our process for allowing the public opportunity to provide comment and input on that new material other than, I guess, the normal process of writing and responding? Is there any discussion of opening up a public hearing after a presentation is made?
Normally, we would have a second public hearing if we reached the point of having final subdivision review.
Okay.
But if anybody wants to approach this differently or has another idea, I'm certain.
No, I just more from my own understanding, making sure that again there was another opportunity for the public to speak, and that we made sure that you know, folks were aware of that. And as long as I understand that, then I'm comfortable knowing that.
Okay, thanks, Barbara.
I hate to be the devil's advocate all the time, but I think if there are substantive changes, and there well may be some substantive changes if we all agree there need to be, then the public should have a right to respond prior to final subdivision approval. Although I'd like to restate that your letters are probably more valuable than the public hearing is, because we have them. I mean, we have a stack like this, and we can go back and refer to them, whereas a public hearing, it is much more difficult to go back and try to restructure what you've said. So, but that is something we might want to consider if there are substantive changes, even if that entails an additional hearing. I don't know that we can make the decision tonight, though.
I'm certainly willing to reserve judgment on that if at the conclusion of tonight's hearing or public meeting, or the February 27th public meeting, we could certainly revisit whether another public hearing makes sense. Fair enough. Okay. John?
Hey, thank you. My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates. I represent Spenwick Woods, LLC. With me this evening is Al Palmer of Goro Palmer Consulting Engineers, Paul Driscoll from Norman Hansen in Detroit, and the three applicants, Jim McFarland, Skip Murray, and Craig Cooper. I'd like to format our presentations very similar to what you outlined, Mr. Chairman. First, just to orient the board once again to the project, to summarize the plan revisions, and then I want to turn it over to Al, who will talk about or just summarize the stormwater revisions to the plan. Turn it over to Paul, who will address the legal issue pertaining to Lot 11, and then conclude by just reviewing some of the topics that were raised at the public hearing that I've highlighted in my letter that's in your packet. First of all, the plan revisions. There are seven that I have listed here. We have removed all of the three retention basins from the project, and Al will get into that during his presentation. We've incorporated an emergency turnaround easement as requested at the intersection of South Street and Astor Lane, and that is shown on the plan. We've added a retaining wall and a guide rail on the westerly side of South Street at the location of the stream crossing. We've added an evergreen buffer along the easterly side of South Street, where the South Street curve is in relatively close proximity to the property line. We've added 11 Tsuga canadensis. We have relocated portions of the trail. We've incorporated a trail easement in the area of the condominium. We've shifted the trail away from the condominium so that it runs now more or less parallel and along the property line. We've incorporated boardwalks at the several of the wetland crossings with the trail. And finally, we've added a stop sign at Chicory and Kildare in this location here. Those essentially are the changes that have been made to the subdivision plan since you last reviewed it. I am going to follow, in our presentation, I am going to follow pretty much in order of this booklet that you have, beginning with our letter, which is in response to Steve Harding's comments. Rather than going through point by point, I will just summarize by saying that with the exception of item 13, Franklin Circle dimensions, we have agreed to and we have addressed all of Steve Harding's comments. The permits, the three state permits were submitted to the state. The stormwater permit was submitted. That was the previous stormwater application. That will be resubmitted in the near future. A copy of the stream crossing has been approved by DEP. We are still waiting for the approval for the NERPA application for the wetland impact. Under stormwater, Al is going to present that. And as I said, we've basically addressed all of Steve Harding's comments. The one item, as I mentioned, item 13, Franklin Circle radius. We've blown this up so the board could see what we're asking for. This is a waiver that we're asking for. What is indicated in this dashed line is in accordance with the subdivision ordinance for the layout of a cul-de-sac. What we're requesting is that we shorten that radius so that it aligns like that. We've put templates on here for emergency vehicles, fire apparatus, buses, and this functions adequately for those types of vehicles. This is just an additional pavement which we'd rather not construct, but we haven't had the chance to meet with Bob Malley and Chief McGoldrick on this, but we would like to do that and see if we can reach an agreement for this waiver. So that's the only item that we have not resolved at this point. At this point, I'm going to ask Al to come up and present the planning of the stormwater.
Just briefly, John, on that waiver that you're requesting, I think the board would just be interested in hearing what the chief and Bob Malley have to say about that.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, ladies and gentlemen. Al Palmer from Goral Palmer. We were retained by the applicant to do the stormwater, and at the last meeting we gave you an overview of what the modifications we were analyzing based upon our meeting with the staff. What I'd like to do is to kind of highlight that change and go over it with you on a very summary basis. If there's specific questions that you have relative to it, I'd be happy to answer those. When we first got involved in the project, we saw this large wetland area, large forested area, as a...
Could you just move that board there? Thanks.
Okay. When we first got involved, we saw this area as being a very positive attribute from a stormwater standpoint. It's a very relatively level area. It's got the wetland complex in it. It's got a nice buffer of wooded vegetation around it. And when we first met with Mitchell Associates, we were looking at trying to incorporate that into the stormwater plan. There's, as we discussed at the last meeting, there's a ridge running between this section of the site here. There's a ridge basically bisecting the parcel here that separates this wetland complex and this forested area from this upland area here. The initial interpretations relative to the large wetland complex had us looking at a 250-foot buffer from the wetland. That buffer went up and over that ridge line, and at the time it was felt that we couldn't get into that buffer area to do any of our stormwater treatment. Because of that assumption, that led us to the three stormwater ponds that we had in the original proposal. One basically in here handling the condominium area, one over in this area that was handling Franklin Circle and these homes, and one in this rear area which was handling those homes. After meeting with the town staff and working with Mitchell and Associates, the interpretation relative to the buffer was modified, and it actually walked itself down the slope away from the top of the ridge. Topographically, that was a major issue for us relative to the stormwater, because when that buffer was 250 feet, the elevation at the outer limit of that buffer didn't allow us to convey the stormwater from these areas to the upland buffer adjacent to those wetlands. It was just too high in elevation. By looking at the modification to that buffer, it allows us to do some work in this area. And what we've proposed, which was submitted as part of the revised package, is to look at using the natural ability of the forested area and the wetlands to act as an attenuator relative to stormwater quantity. All of you have walked through the woods, and all of you have been onto this site. When you're walking through those woods, it's a very gradual grade when you get down into this area. Again, at the ridge, there's very steep topography when you're coming off of the knoll, but then it comes down to a lower, flatter elevation, and what we're trying to do is to use that area to attenuate the stormwater. Use its natural ability to absorb the water, slow it down, and assist us in managing both the quantity of runoff coming from the site, but also to give us water quality aspects. Both the wooded area and the wetland has what I would call a pit and mound topography. It's very indicative of normal woods in Maine. When you're walking through it, you know, there's microtopographic changes in those woods that allow us to discharge the stormwater to it, get some natural storage to occur during a storm, and have it bleed itself out through the adjacent wetlands. What our current proposal does is use that area to maximize the stormwater treatment. We're proposing three level lip spreaders in this area, and they're going to be taking the flow from Franklin Circle in this section of South Street, conveying it through a storm drain pipe through the ridge and discharging into this area. The condominium development is going to be again collected, for the most part, most of the condominium area will be collected and discharged into two level lip spreaders up in this area. And again, this is just an aerial photo showing the same thing, but it does show some of the surrounding areas. Again, this is a large wetland area here that you've got there. This is the Maxwell Pond, and then you've got South Street, Franklin Circle, and the condominiums. The ability to take that stormwater, disperse it into the woods, is allowing us to slow it down, get some storage to occur in the natural wooded areas and within the wetland, so that when it leaves the site, and that we've analyzed 8 different locations, but one of the largest obvious areas is down in here, but we've analyzed 8 different locations around the perimeter, we're at or below pre-development levels. The level lip spreaders are a means for us to spread the water out into the wooded areas. Rather than having a pipe that's discharging at a point, we're going to be creating a swale. Once we get below the pipe, we'll be creating a swale that will have areas where the water will be able to spill over the edge of it and disperse into the wetland into a sheet flow environment, trying to spread it out, get it to go through the forest duff, and to maximize the treatment of it, rather than having one pipe discharging, which you've all seen at various roads. We're trying to spread it out into the woods. And again, in this area, we're about 100 feet above the wetlands with that discharge, and the same over in this area. So we're going to be getting treatment through the forested upland buffer, get storage and treatment in the wetland area before it gets discharged. The modified stormwater report was submitted to your town engineer. I believe you have copies of the comments from them. In reviewing their comments, they agree with the approach that we've taken on the stormwater management plan. They've got a couple of comments that they would like us to address before final approval, but we don't see those comments being anything that would change the conclusion of the study, that using the forested buffer is the best management tool that we can to handle the stormwater for the project. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have relative to the stormwater.
Are there any questions on that? Jack?
Has any analysis been done to determine how much, say a 25-year storm or 100-year storm, would bring runoff water into there that might overflow into yards of neighboring homes?
I missed the last part.
Has analysis been done for a large storm to determine how large a storm it would take for the runoff water that's all collecting there to overflow into yards of neighboring homes?
We analyzed, and again, this would apply to all of the 8 points that we have around the property. We analyzed the 2-year, the 10-year, and the 25-year storm to verify that we're at or below pre-development levels for peak flow exiting the site, and to demonstrate that we wouldn't have an adverse impact on flooding of any of the downstream properties. So we did analyze up to the 25-year storm in accordance with your ordinance.
Was that done in conjunction with the detention ponds, or with this revised?
It was actually done with both, but that includes the revised analysis where we're using the forested area to get the attenuation.
Okay, thank you.
Barbara?
I certainly think it looks a lot better than having those detention basins all over. However, we're removing most, or you're removing most of the forested area, and how does that affect the flow of the water? I mean, where those condominiums are and those houses are, there aren't going to be any trees. They're going to be gone with this plan. And how does that affect the flow? How did you take that into consideration when analyzing? And I've got your chart. I didn't quite understand all of it, but I did read it.
Yep.
In front of me.
The stormwater analysis treats as a baseline condition the existing condition that's out there today. The forested cover, the topographic divides that occur, and we analyze the different areas as they leave off site. For example, a portion of this area existing exits the site, goes towards the Maxwell Pond, but actually doesn't get to the Maxwell Pond, comes down, around, but comes right back onto the site. So this area today drains in this direction, but then it turns itself and comes back up through the wetland complex. We modeled that under today's conditions as a forested area based upon the slopes that are out there. We then, in both the original analysis and the revised one, look at converting all of this area to either lawn, pavement, or roofs, so that we get the change in the surface conditions and the change in the topographic conditions, the change in grading, and model that as the proposed conditions. Take that into consideration when we're routing it through and bringing it into this area. So the post-development after build condition reflects the loss of the tree cover. It does show an increase in total runoff exiting the site. Obviously, the amount of water that exits the site overall does increase the total volume, but the peak flow, which is what would cause any impacts downstream, is at or below existing levels. That we reviewed with the town engineer, and he concurs with that recommendation. So we do take into consideration the change in cover type from trees to pavement, but because of the ability of the existing woodlands to absorb that flow, it attenuates any increase in peak flow so that we don't have the flooding downstream.
You're saying that there is an increase in flow, but at the peak times, there's a decrease in flow. And I guess I'm not understanding the, maybe everybody else understands, and if they do, that's fine, because I'm only one.
Do you understand how, when we had the detention basins, how those detention basins capture the storm water and release it over time so that we mimic the existing conditions?
Yes.
Think of this wooded area as basically a large detention basin. Instead of going in and excavating a basin and using that for the storage, we're spreading it out over a larger area.
I understand.
So that we are seeing this area is staying saturated. We are seeing, you know, that we are going to be modifying the hydraulic regime in that area. But it, just because of the natural topography, the fact that it is a very flat basin, we're able to get the storage in there that replicates the storage we would have done in a detention basin. I think on the 25-year storm, we were seeing that there was going to be about a 2-inch increase in the elevation of the water going through the wetlands.
But it's spread over a larger area. So.
Spread over a larger area and a longer time.
Thank you.
There's been a lot of communication that this is some newfangled that has never been attempted before. Is that correct? I find it a little bit hard to believe, since it seems like a natural way to disperse water. But are there other examples of this type of dispersal?
It is. It's a concept that isn't used as much as it really should be. The Maine Department of Environmental Protection is very stringent relative to use of wetlands to treat stormwater and to use wetlands as a detention area. In this case, by discharging to the upland area, to the forested uplands above it, we're getting enough treatment of the water before it gets to the wetlands that it meets the DEP guidelines. Most projects that we deal with, and I'm sure that you see, the development footprint goes right to the edge of the wetlands, and you don't have a lot of buffer between the wetlands and the development. In those cases, the DEP basically prohibits us from this type of a concept. But in this area where we do have this vegetated buffer, they allow it because we're getting to use the upland area to treat the water before it hits the wetlands. So it is something that we're seeing an increased likelihood of being used, but we need to have a site that allows us to have that upland area before we can discharge to the wetlands.
What's actually in the ground? Is it pipes that disperse? I'm just thinking of maintenance.
Yep. Basically, from both Franklin Circle and from the condominiums, there will be a storm drain pipe that will convey the flow to the area of the level lip spreaders. The level lip spreader will then basically be a swale, a ditch, that we're constructing parallel to the slope, that at certain levels, in this case, we've got three areas where we build the swale, and we'll have one section that's got a little bit lower sidewall, so that the water can then go over that, discharge through the forested area. But we're spacing those out so that we get a longer area to discharge those flows, keep the erosion down by having the velocities very low. So when you walk through it, and it is something that we need to coordinate with John's office relative to the trail, it's going to look just like it's a ditch or a swale, a very shallow and broad swale that during a non-storm event you're really not going to notice. During a storm event, you may see 6 inches of water going through there, and again, at certain areas, we'll lower the side of the ditch so that the water can spill over and go into the forested area. We are, one of the comments from the town engineer, obviously, was to address maintenance. We are going to be working with John's office so that basically there'll be an area that over the pipe, when we're putting the pipe section in, they would be able to access, and then on the uphill side of the level lip spreader, again, a cleared area that may be 8 to 10 feet wide, so they could take a small loader excavator in to do any maintenance.
Al, I have three questions for you. First, regarding the location of the pipes, the storm pipes to the level lip spreader, have those locations been identified? And if not, what opportunity do we have to, if this development moves forward, what opportunity do we have in locating these pipes so that we maximize the number of trees in an area that remains undisturbed?
The drainage plans that we've submitted, we've selected a location for the pipes and for the level lip spreaders. Again, as a construction detail, what we would be looking at would be to have that laid out in the field and then walk it with John's office so that we can tweak those locations in the field. A lot of times, again, when you get out to construction, we see that, okay, if we shift that level lip spreader 10 feet in one direction, we can save, you know, some nice specimen trees. What we would recommend is that we lay it out and have it flagged in the field, do a site walk with John's office and probably somebody from the town staff to see, okay, how can we tweak the alignment in the field to minimize clearing and maximize retention of some of the specimen trees that are out there.
And I'm assuming something like the detail you're describing could be noted on the plan so that it's understood, you know, through the process where that could be located and the flexibility that might be, you know, in doing that.
Right.
Okay. Second question, Al, you've talked a little bit about maintenance and understanding that the town ultimately assumes responsibility for maintenance. Can you describe for the board generally what would be required to maintain the level lip spreaders on an annual basis?
The biggest issue with the level lip spreaders would be transport of sediment off the roadways. If we've got some sanding that's occurring in the roadway that isn't captured within the catch basins, that may work itself through the storm drain piping into the ditch. Again, what we would recommend is probably twice a year, somebody from Public Works going out visually inspecting the ditch line, making sure we're not getting an excessive buildup of sediments. If we are, depending on the volume, either remove it manually or bring in a small loader excavator and remove it. The other thing that they would be looking for is any signs of erosion or undercutting of that swale. So from a maintenance standpoint, they're very low intensity. We have designed the level lip spreaders so that they're significantly below the standard required by the DEP. The Maine Department of Environmental Protection for a 10-year storm allows us to discharge a certain volume of water over those level lip spreaders per foot. The maximum we're doing is 40% of what the DEP recommends. So we basically are taking their maximum flow, cutting in half, so we can reduce the velocities and increase the dispersion of the flow downstream.
Maureen, I'm assuming the town is aware that they will be responsible for maintenance of the level lip spreaders.
Yes, I spoke to the Public Works Director. In fact, he has one already he maintains over at the Public Works Garage, and he's aware that he would need to get to this, and we've talked about an 8-foot wide path that would be incorporated as part of the trails. Okay. and he said that would be sufficient for him to have access to it.
Great. Third and last question, Al. Again, knowing that there are concerns relative to drainage and that this is somewhat of a new technique, is there any potential monitoring that should be suggested to, I guess, confirm the performance of this wetland in doing what it's supposed to do, and how might that be done if it was in place?
The analysis is very theoretical. We're using a synthetic rainfall distribution for a 25-year storm. It assumes 5.4 inches of rainfall over a 24-hour period, but it assumes a certain distribution of that rainfall during the storm, so that at the peak period, the peak 15-minute period during that storm, we're getting a certain rainfall. In reality, it never rains the way the models indicate. You can have a 2-inch rainfall that, from an intensity standpoint, is the equivalent of a 25-year storm. You can have a 7-inch rainfall that occurs over a longer period of time that is no more intense than a 2-year storm. So from a maintenance or a monitoring standpoint, it's almost impossible to go out and say, okay, this is the perfect storm, and we're going to gauge the elevations that are out there. It's more... It would be more of a qualitative analysis by, say, the public works staff of, are they seeing discharges over the level lip spreaders that may indicate that we need to spread the flow out more? Again, right now we've got 3 proposed here and 2 down here, which is basically, I think we've got about 3 times the amount of length that the DEP would recommend. We've done that to try and maximize the absorption going through that forested area. If Public Works saw that we were getting some erosion at one of those areas, we may want to continue one of the level lip spreaders and lengthen it out.
Great, thank you. Jack?
I have 2 questions. One as a follow-up to Barbara's question. Are there any other developments in this area that you've been involved with that use this way of dispersing stormwater? I meant a larger development than just a garage.
I would need to research that. The DEP in November modified their rules where the proposed modifications that they're doing are encouraging this type of design. Rather than going in and doing detention basins, collecting it all and discharging it in one point, spreading it out using vegetated buffers. We could work with staff to see if there's some examples of projects that are similar to this. I do have some commercial projects where we haven't done the level lip spreaders to the extent we've done this. We've done them on a much more limited basis, but we have used the wetland area and the vegetated buffer beside it to do the detention.
Second question, is any consideration given to how the dissipative character of the wetlands might be affected by winter salt running in there, and then in the summer fertilizer, phosphorus, nitrogen running in there?
Again, that goes to Mr. Siegfried's comment. Discharging it to the upland forested area before it gets to the wetland is a key item for the DEP. If we were trying to do this and put the level lip spreaders 10 feet from the wetlands, they would have those concerns and issues. And based on my experience, they wouldn't allow it. By moving those structures about 100 feet above the wetland, what we're getting is we're getting the treatment through that forest duff that takes care of those issues before it gets to the wetlands. The minimum that the DEP under the current guidelines is looking for is about a 75-foot buffer to get that treatment, and I believe we've got 100 feet above the wetlands where we're doing it.
Is that treatment just for sedimentary materials, or is it also for dissolved materials?
The DEP hasn't come out with any quantitative analysis relative to the road salts or any of those other items. They use the total suspended solids as their indicator and their indicator species relative to, if we're getting the treatment on the total suspended solids, then they feel that we're getting a comparable treatment on the road salts and any other factors that would be affecting the wetlands. So they look at the total suspended solids in sizing the buffers, but they feel that that's an indicative of how they, what kind of treatment they're getting for those other factors.
Well, do you consider dissolved materials as suspended solids?
The dissolved materials are different, but what you're seeing is it going through the organic matter in the forest duff. You're seeing treatment there. You're seeing some infiltration occurring through the upland areas. And the, although the level of treatment's different, what the national studies have shown is if you get the treatment on the suspended solids, you're getting corresponding levels of treatment on the dissolved matter and the other pollutants that are in stormwater runoff.
Thank you.
Barbara.
For the proposed lots up on the upper left-hand side, where the land is actually below, the level of the land is below where it is, where you're putting the yes.
Yep.
How is that water going to be removed from there, by pipes?
Again, what, yeah, I'm going to look to Will. How many level of spreaders do we have back there?
Two.
The, again, we've got the developed area, and then we've got the open space. We are looking at siting two level lip spreaders there so that as the flow comes off the roadway and comes off the lots, we have an opportunity to, again, disperse it into a forested buffer, get the treatment, get the attenuation before it goes to the offsite areas. So we've got three here, two here, and two more over here. I didn't really focus on those, but we do have two additional level lip spreaders in that area.
What about to the right of that, which flows into, and there's some pretty substantial standing water in that area, up in that area.
Up in this area?
Yes. Where is that going to? Because the land there, it also goes uphill from there.
Yep. What we're trying to do, and that's a point of interest, do you have a plan? That area, we are looking at trying to reduce the overall area that drains to that. And by reducing the area and taking some of that flow in this direction, it cuts down the levels that are going.
But how are you going to do that? How are you proposing to do that when that land actually lies lower than this land that you're talking about over here? It has to go uphill before it goes downhill.
Again, we're piping it through that ridge.
Oh, okay. So you are using pipes.
Right. Again, what you'll see is we've got pipe system within the roadway. We're actually, I believe it's between lots 18 and 19. We're going to be piping it between those lots, around the ridge, and then discharging it to that swale. So we do have to take it underneath the, through a pipe system to get it through that knoll.
And so none of it will add to that rather large wetland area?
Correct.
Any other questions or comments from the board on the stormwater management plan? I mean, go ahead, John.
It seems like there's, for Goral Pond, I mean, this, if this is a new, a relatively new idea, and the DEP is promoting this solution for dispersal of stormwater, maybe there's some opportunity for Goral Palmer to take more ownership of this, I don't want to say project, but this idea. And if it turns out to be a good idea and it works well, of course, you're going to be promoting this in possibly other places. But if we all of a sudden have big ditches where sand is running down gullies into, then this is a bad thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is there some mechanism to, I don't know, get more ownership?
I stated another way, what happens if this doesn't work?
We know who the attorneys are.
On the one hand, we're encouraging, it seems to me the planning board is encouraging you to do this, the DEP is encouraging you, town staff is. So it seems unfair to then say, well, if it doesn't work, then the developer's going to come back in and redo the whole system. But I don't know, maybe the town planner can give us any guidance on this. I mean, once we approve this, normally, wouldn't it be up to the town to maintain it and make sure it works?
Yes, and I'll be honest with you. nice man you saw at the beginning of the evening, Mr. Malley, the Public Works Director, is very conservative about taking on stuff that doesn't work. Well, the town has used some alternative strategies. I mean, we have a weir system that was installed in the 80s that the town maintains for the Stone Gate subdivision, and we're still maintaining it, and we haven't had any problems. The level lip spreader is something that is out his window of his office, and it's a fairly large one. It covers not just the Public Works garage, but the fall fields that are out there and the paved areas. And there's a significant amount of paved area around the Public Works garage, if you've ever been out there. It isn't that unique a technology. The other thing to think about is that one of the things I appreciate about engineers is they like to quantify everything. So they know exactly how much rainfall falls in the state of Maine every year. And they know very quantitatively how much water will be absorbed into the ground based on the type of soil that you have. So what Mr. Palmer has factored in there but isn't sharing with us is they probably had a discussion about which grade of ledgy soil they were allowed to categorize this particular property as. They had to calculate how much water comes off of it now. And then there was a lot of discussion. In his report, you have lots that average about 7,500 square feet, and he's calculated that 3,000 square feet of every lot is going to not be absorbing any stormwater at all. So he's got a fixed amount of water that he has to deal with. They have a pretty good idea of how fast water can flow on ground that has this soil type before it starts to erode. So that's why he spent a lot of time talking to you about the slope there, because, you know, if the slope's like this, it really doesn't matter what kind of soil it is, because it's going to leave the site fairly quickly. He's calculated that, you know, forest and duff, which is a lot of leaf litter on the ground, and the board members who were out there without the snow found that there is a lot of leaf litter on the ground. So that also slows down the water, makes the greater opportunity for water to be absorbed. So, you know, we have this professional engineer looking at it. We have the Department of Environmental Protection's engineer looking at it. And we also have our own town engineer, Steve Harding, who, by the way, if this doesn't work, is going to be the one that gets the phone call. So, you know, he does look at it from the perspective of not wanting to get a nasty phone call from the Public Works Director saying, you need to come find a way to fix this. I don't think it's that cutting edge. And I just want to remind the board that, you know, we did look at a couple of very large detention basins at the Blueberry Ridge project that nobody was happy with. And, you know, you tried to find ways to landscape them, and, you know, it's hard to landscape the big holes. So, I mean, this is an alternative that, you know, you did kind of push, that you really wanted to try to find something other than detention basins.
Maureen's points are all very appropriate in a lot of the factors that we looked at. Again, we do know that it hasn't been done a lot. It is the direction that the DEP is going to be pushing all applicants who have to do a stormwater permit. We didn't want to push the envelope too far, though, from a design standpoint. The one item that we've seen, and again, it's more based on practical experience and seeing it in the field, if we try and put too much flow through each of these level lip spreaders, what we'll see happen is immediately below the level lip spreader, it'll be stable. As it works its way further down and the flow comes back into being some type of a channelized flow, we'll start to see some erosion. And that's more just from a practical view of what we've seen built over the last 10 years. Specifically, these three level lip spreaders, under the DEP's best management practices, we could go with one 18-foot long level lip spreader. It would meet the flow requirements that they have as part of their design. We've proposed it as three 25-foot level lip spreaders so that we spread that flow out over a longer distance so that we don't get that concentrated flow below the level lip spreaders. By the time we take and pipe that flow from here over to this side, extending that ditch an extra 75 feet to build those level lip spreaders allows us to disperse it over a much larger area, and based upon our anecdotal review of the level lip spreaders, will minimize any problems downstream. if, again, we were pushing the envelope relative to what the department said we could discharge. I have seen them where they concentrate the flow below it, and it leads to some erosion downstream. That's why we're basically discharging from those level lip spreaders at one-fifth of what the DEP would allow us. It's going to cost them a little bit more money to build, but again, we're trying to minimize the maintenance issues down the road.
Jack?
Is there any provision for periodic monitoring of the quality of the wetlands, see if the quality has been impacted by materials carried down there?
The DEP has not required, based on our discussions with them, qualitative monitoring for the wetlands. What they're looking at is if we can meet their standard relative to setback from the wetlands, they accept that relative to a discharge, and that will not have a detrimental effect on those wetlands. Because again, it is extremely difficult to measure a wetland from year to year relative to environmental impacts and items that may have an effect on it. This last year, I believe, from January to December, was the wettest year that we've had on record in the state of Maine. The quality of the wetlands in the spring of this coming year is going to be significantly different than years past where we've had more drought conditions. So there's a lot of environmental effects that makes it very difficult to say, okay, we've built this project, how does that affect the wetlands, and separate that from, okay, what are the total rainfall that we've seen, what are the changes from acid rain, and how do you select and say, okay, this wetland was affected by this development and not taken into consideration those other items.
On a semi-annual or even an annual basis, one data point, you know, could be way off, but you could see a trend, a multi-year trend developing, if there were one.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be my concern, that we wouldn't be surprised by the impacts of a 50-year storm when all of a sudden we'd realize that those wetlands had deteriorated for the past 10 years and we didn't know about it. And there's major flooding as a consequence. So that's my concern there. So a trend kind of mm-hmm. observation or monitoring.
All right. That's not the direction that the DEP is going relative to their long-term plans.
Unless there are any further questions or comments on this issue, I think we ought to move on to the next. John, I don't know what the next issue you wanted to address. Is that the legal issue of the lawn from the hall? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to address this evening. I'm Paul Driscoll. I'm a lawyer with Norman Hanson in Detroit. I've been asked to represent Spurwick Woods, LLC, in connection with this project. At the December 20th hearing, there was a discussion concerning the legal issues associated with Lot 11, which is, for everybody's benefit, this lot here. And there were the two issues that were raised, I think were best presented by Richard Bryant and his wife as to one of the issues, and the other was by Mr. Keck and his wife. Concerning the use of Lot 11 to support access to this subdivision. Lot 11 is part of an historic subdivision that was approved in 1966 by the town of Cape Elizabeth for a large project. I don't know the exact scope of it. Mr. Bryant and Ms. Najemi question whether it's appropriate for a residential lot in a subdivision to be used and dedicated to provide access to an adjacent subdivision. And he alluded to a one decided case that implied that there was an implied restriction that it be used solely for residential purposes, and he questioned whether it was appropriate legally to use that for road access to the adjacent subdivision. So as a result of that point that was raised at the December 20th hearing, we went back and did the legal research and found this case specifically to which we believe he's referring because it isn't cited in his letter. And that's the ALC Development Corp case versus who now, Walker. That's a 2002 Maine Supreme Court decision which held that in that particular case, a lot in a residential subdivision could not be used to provide access for a roadway to an adjacent subdivision. So on the surface of it, it seems to support his position. But if you dig into it, you'll find that the case says, and the critical point on which the Maine Supreme Court ruled was that the deeds in that subdivision explicitly restricted the lots to residential purposes only, all right? And so we undertook an investigation of the deeds in the Mitchell Heights subdivision, which is this one here, where from which Lot 11 comes, and there is no such restriction. There's no restriction in the deed into the developer, nor in the chain of title. And Spurwink Woods has an option on that lot and has adequate right title and interest for it. So our view of it is that the case that Richard cited, Richard's a lawyer, as we all know, was more directed to that specific provision in that case that dealt with the legal restriction that affirmatively restricted it for residential purposes only. So our view of it is that there's nothing in the deeds or the chain of title, nor for that matter in the approval conditions for Mitchell Heights subdivision that would prohibit the use of that lot for access to the adjacent subdivision. The next issue that was raised, and I'm happy to answer questions on that if you, but I could go to the next point if you would like.
Go ahead, John.
Was that terminology used back in 1962? I don't know if you know that. For residential purposes only, was that a term that was at that time?
Certainly. Yeah. It was 1966 when that approval occurred, and there were, as I think Mr. Sherman and maybe Mr. Hayden also, our attorneys, there are classic land use restrictions that are used in deeds back to England in the 1600s, probably even further back. So.
Did you have a question, Barbara?
You go ahead.
Actually, I'm also familiar with that ALC development case. Are there, in the Mitchell Highlands subdivision, or is it Mitchell Heights or Mitchell?
Mitchell Heights. Oh, it's Heights, I'm sorry.
Are there any restrictions, any types of restrictions on the individual lots?
I didn't do a comprehensive title search on all of the lots. We went back to the subdivision approval criteria, and there was nothing there, no. Okay. Nothing that spoke to this specific issue. That's what we were looking at.
And not having researched the issue as thoroughly as you have, has there ever been an argument that if you create a subdivision, it's implicit in the plan, if you're creating, I don't know how many scores of lots, that they would be used for single-family homes? Has that type of argument ever been made?
Well, I can say, if you're asked the question, has it ever been made, it probably has been, because it's just been the way things are. But I don't view that as an estate in land that would restrict some lot owner. If, for instance, let's assume that it wasn't going to be used, say zoning allowed like a professional office there, and there was no restriction in the deed or in any approval condition, I question whether it would be lawful or appropriate for a regulatory body to kind of imply one and insert it. From our standpoint, reviewing it, there is no restriction that would prohibit this development of the roadway. I would point out that during the course of the day, I was in touch with Mr. Hill, who I understand is the town's counsel. I won't characterize his conclusions because I know he's written to you separately, or I understand that he's going to if he has not. But I believe he concurs in my assessment that there is no restriction or legal impediment that would prevent the use of Lot 11 for the reasons that I'm articulating.
But we do actually now have in our possession a...
I'd be very interested to see that, by the way.
Letter,
oh, you do?
A letter hot off the presses of its facts to us this evening or late this afternoon. So if you want to take a look at it, for a minute,
you're
welcome to, and maybe the members of the planning board, we could each take a minute or two to read through it. It's a letter dated January 17, 2006 from Michael Hill, who is the town's attorney on this issue.
Okay. I've had an opportunity to review Michael's letter, and it seems perfectly consistent with the discussions we had this afternoon. I believe that he actually uses the expression, maybe that's where I heard it, that there is no legal impediment to removing land from one previously approved subdivision and having it be made a part of another one. He also makes the point that if there is any type of private land use restriction that exists between or an implied dedication to residential purposes, that it's not within the purview of the planning board to decide those issues. The issue is whether or not there's adequate right, title, and interest, which I think is conceded. And if there is an implied dedication to the, some extent that an abutter could raise a question about, then they have a right to bring a declaratory judgment action or to join that as part of the anticipated 80B approval or process once this application is considered and acted on.
Peter?
Not surprisingly, the attorney gets most questions from the attorney. Most questions to the engineer. I think the latter point is quite clear, which is that the private lot restrictions really have nothing to do with this board.
Right.
But I'm as interested to know what you looked at and what you didn't look at, just for my own clarification. Did you look back at the original Mitchell Highland conditions of approval in the town's files to see whether there was anything mentioned there? I just want to be clear.
We didn't go through the town's files specifically. We just did through, and in fairness and candor, it was not me who examined these things with my abstractor, but it was my office who did it.
Right, but you looked at the title recorded restrictions.
We did.
Either on
Correct.
The deed or on the plan
Correct.
Or whatever.
Correct, and that included plan notes and things of that nature. That's
right.
What we would check for.
And none of those spoke to the issue.
Correct.
But you haven't looked at the town file yet.
Right.
And then the other question I have is, I mean, generally in a subdivision approval, if you start, you know, in the vernacular, fiddling around with lot lines, you come back for an amendment or a modification. I'm having a hard time seeing why you wouldn't come back for an amendment on the earlier plan. Especially if you're removing, well, not only are you changing lot lines,
yep.
which you clearly are on that
right.
lot, you're removing part of one of the lots, and now you're affecting two lots. And then you're also talking about removing one of those two lots out from the subdivision approval completely. It seems to me that if you're doing that without bringing it back for modification, and I know this is a technical point, it's, you're sort of stuck with both layers of approvals,
right.
for good or bad. And I think...
I agree with that.
You know, I guess I disagree slightly with Mike's analysis about, well, you can do it implicitly in the second approval. I think sort of the more better way to do it, or it would be to bring back the other one for modification. Then you have a clear record
right.
As to what each lot contains and what restrictions apply to it.
Fair enough. And
okay.
My view of it is, I think I actually said that in my submission.
Yeah,
the
second last paragraph, I'm just saying, it's at this point, isn't it appropriate, Maureen, maybe for them to bring forward the modification, put it on the agenda so we're considering it all at the same time?
We could modify the current application to include that.
Okay.
As one of the things that's part of the approval.
Okay, which would take it out of the previous approval.
It's not unusual when you're reviewing a plan, all of a sudden you trip over a wetland alteration, you add the resource protection permit in. It's the same kind of idea.
Okay.
Maureen, have you had an opportunity to review the original subdivision plan for Mitchell Highlands?
My next question.
Oh. Actually, I did, and we don't have a file on the
plan.
What we have is copies of the recording plats from
okay.
the registry. And I have, they're in three pieces, but I do have them here. And there's, you know, it's a 1965, 1966 recordings. There are no restrictions as to the uses of the lots.
But we don't have anything beyond that in terms of a set of minutes like we generate
no,
today.
In 1965, there wasn't a planning board that was doing this kind of thing. Well, let me correct that. In 1965, there was a planning board that did sign these plans, but we don't have minutes to do that.
Peter, did you have anything else?
No, I didn't.
want to go to part?
The second point, and that was a point that was best articulated in Mr. Hoffman's and Ms. Keck's letter, which I think was dated December 20th or the 19th, I can't remember, but it dealt with whether the construction of Chicory Way over Lot 11 would make Lot 11 non-conforming as to square footage. And they said that that because this was going to be in there and that was already being used as a residential lot, that would be inappropriate to make that lot non-conforming because obviously the roadway wouldn't be part of the residential structure on the property. And I think what that overlooks is that this land in the adjacent subdivision, we have right title and interest in by virtue of the deed and the option, and that project, that land is being submitted as part of this project. And so we are asking this body to review and to apply the subdivision zoning criteria for this lot as part of the overall project. And in that regard, it complies. This lot, the density calculations have all been factored into the thinking on the whole project. And it's clear that is fully in compliance if considered a part of the subdivision application, which it is, okay? And so superficially, that has some appeal to it, the idea that, well, this lot is now non-conforming, but what that it's ignoring that it's coming into this project, and the implication of the assumption is that you're now taking a lot that was conforming in the other project, making it non-conforming, considered it in isolation, and that's inappropriate. That's the general drift of the argument. But what's really happening is that entire lot with Chicory Way on it is being put into this project. It's subject to all the development criteria, all the calculations, square footage, density, lot coverage ratios, everything, and it has to comply with all of those standards or it can't be approved. And it does. It does comply.
Barbara?
I'm really troubled by this. I'm troubled by both the town attorney's response and yours. You only looked at one case that somebody mentioned, and
actually,
I know...
They didn't mention it, actually. I found it.
Okay. I mean, there are lots of cases, and you could find lots of things if you looked, I believe, in legal research. But I'm troubled by the fact that the town attorney says as long as they have clear title. Well, when they bought the parcel of land, they bought it as a parcel in Mitchell Highlands subdivision. They didn't buy it as a parcel in Spurwink Woods. So when the people sold it to them, they probably had no idea. They were selling a house and a lot. And then the lot was placed in this subdivision to meet the standards of this subdivision, taken from another subdivision. So I don't see the fact that they have title to the land really answers the question about whether or not this is a correct use of the lot. I also understand that the town manager and the town staff is very much in favor of putting roads through so that there is more than one access to subdivisions. I understand that clearly. But in dealing with this lot, that they have clear title to it doesn't seem to answer the questions for me. And the other question on the secondary lot where an easement is coming, what is the size remaining of that lot? It's supposed to be 20,000 square feet in Mitchell Highlands subdivision.
You're referring to Lot 11, ma'am?
Referring to the, I forgot their
name. Hills?
Hillsy Lot
Hills.
Or something.
That's right here.
It's over there.
It's over there.
Maybe my questions aren't, what I'm saying isn't very clear, but.
No, I understand it very well, I think. What you're, okay. And if I can characterize it, you have the impression or the concern that because Lot 11 was already in another subdivision, it's kind of, in a sense, perpetually part of that other subdivision, and it cannot be used to be put into any adjacent land. And I really, know of no legal principle that says that. I mean, all land comes from someplace. But the fact that it is not, it can be an adjacent subdivision, as long as it's what's the the applicant has adequate right, title, and interest, there's no question about that here, and is submitting the aggregate of its properties, some of which came from non-subdivision property and some of which came from a former subdivision, as long as the aggregate of those properties complies with your zoning and subdivision criteria and approval standards, then it's appropriate to consider it that way. I mean, put another way, I don't know of any principle that says land that is in one subdivision cannot be put into another one with town approval.
Assuming, like in this case apparently, there's no restrictions to the original approval.
Right.
I think this case is totally different if the original Mitchell Highland subdivision said all these lots can only be used for residential use.
We would not be having this discussion of
exactly.
this.
Exactly, but it doesn't say that, Barbara, and that's where I think I do agree with Mike Hill's analysis on that point. I just, plus, you can always go in and amend any subdivision to make a lot or any other part of it comply with some other part of the zoning that's different from the original approval, and that's essentially the way I'm looking at it, the way the developer is doing it. I mean, if they simply took out the house and there was, again, no restrictions on the use of each part of the land and made the road go through that, and I'm not saying they should or shouldn't, I'm just saying they're within their rights to do that, assuming, like they're doing, we're asking for us to amend that part of the subdivision, the original subdivision. So I guess I understand what they're doing and how they're doing it. There's no restrictions on that lot that would stop them from doing that, at least public restrictions. The private issue is, frankly, between whoever may have those rights and the applicant.
Jack, did you have a comment?
I did. Actually, I had two questions. There's been once or twice in my life I wished I was a lawyer. and so I'll ask you, I'm a little bit confused, I guess, as Barbara was too, by part of Mike Hill's letter, and particularly the second page, the first paragraph, top second page, he concludes by saying, we express no opinion as to whether the factual issues of this request meet the requirements of section 16-2-5 or 16-3-1. Well, that doesn't make this letter particularly useful to me.
Well, I think I think what that is meant to say, I'm sorry.
16-2-5 and 16-2-5 is the subdivision amendment procedure.
I know.
And 16-3-1 is the subdivision standards. And the only body that has the authority to decide whether the standards have been met is the planning board, then a judge in an appeal. And that's why he doesn't want to sound, Mike Hill is avoiding any appearance that he is speaking or telling you what to do.
Right.
Because you have authority to make that decision.
Well, he's counseled the zoning board and planning board before. He hasn't refrained from expressing opinions before in the same manner he is now, so that's worrisome.
16-3, I mean, no one has the authority to make that decision except the planning board, and then the only other way, you can't even appeal that to the council. It's the planning board, and then if someone believes that you have not appropriately applied the standards, it goes to court. But that's why he has no authority to put himself in the position of making the planning board's decisions.
I think in a different way, when he's writing on this letter about it, the procedure to get to a point, but he's not addressing the substance of whether this amendment should be approved or not.
Like I said, there's been one or two occasions where I wished I was a lawyer.
Oh, okay.
But the second question is, maybe Maureen, this is maybe a question for you more than for Paul, and that is, how does this road coming through Lot 11, which currently exists as part of a different subdivision, play into our bisected lots amendment?
This particular road, Chicory Way, has nothing to do with the bisected lots amendment right now. Actually, if...
It's not splitting.
If you were to take... If the applicants didn't own that lot, if it was owned by somebody else, and the applicants bought 50 feet from the private property owner and put their road through, they would have they wouldn't be able to do that because the lot would still be in the Mitchell Highlands subdivision and they would have reduced the size of it and which was, would probably be below legal requirements, and they would have altered the lot lines of the subdivision without the permission of the planning board. The bisect, the lots amendment would apply to this lot if the lot was not owned by the applicant and the private property owner provided a 50-foot wide easement down the middle of the lot, through the lot to the other side, and then did not leave a minimum of 20,000 square feet on either side of the lot. So the bisected lot amendment does not apply to it right now because, one, there is no actual right-of-way yet, but two, the lot isn't being bisected by a road right-of-way. The entire lot, if you think of the subdivision as many different pieces of land being merged into one very oddly shaped lot, and then from that point, they started creating road rights of way. So lot 11, under the new proposal, is not bisected. It's a brand new 12,111 square foot.
No, I understand that, but it's not yet part of the new.
But it's proposed to be.
It's proposed to be.
And the applicants have shown that they have right title or interest to the lot, so they have a right to include it. If they didn't have a purchase and sale agreement or if they didn't own it, they couldn't show it as part of the project. But they do own it. And they've provided us with deeds. And if there's a question about whether they actually own it, we can go through the big book that they submitted. But I mean, they own two big pieces. They own that one, and they own, what is it, five different lots they bought from
but
the town.
But mine, again, I wish I had a more comprehensive legal understanding of this. Right now, this is still part of an older subdevelopment.
But they own it, and they're proposing, if they were to just divide it right now, you're right, that wouldn't be right. It would be a bad thing. But they're proposing to create a new lot.
I understand what they're proposing.
With the approval of the planning board. So they haven't done anything to the lot yet. They're waiting to record their approval, at which time it would change.
The first step have to be to amend the previous development approval?
It can happen concurrent with this review. It can all be done at the same time.
I haven't seen any proposal for that yet.
And I think if the board, I mean, your attorney has said they don't need to do it. Their attorney has said they're willing to do it. I think if the board wants to tell this applicant, you know, when you submit your plans next month, make sure you include an amended subdivision application as part of that, and the applicant can decide what they're going to do with that direction.
Yeah. I think they need to, but that's my opinion.
Any other comments on that? Oh, we probably ought to give the applicant some direction, though, on whether we want to see an application to amend the Mitchell Highlands subdivision.
It seems to me that's what's called for.
Okay.
We are using that land. It is part of a subdivision. This body has jurisdiction to amend prior approved subdivisions. So.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Barbara, just to get back to your comment, if you're a homeowner right now and you back into undeveloped open space, and you don't want to see your old home become the roadway into that open space, you can place a restriction on your deed when you convey it to the next owner, indicating that your lot is to be used only for single residential family use. And I know that
that's unfair. We're asking all homeowners to be attorneys, and I'm just troubled by this. I think this is a very difficult decision, and I think that this is a very controversial situation, and
we need to
be careful about considering everything. And I know I've said if you don't like something, then buy the land. But I think that there are limits to what we can expect people to know.
Well, the reason I raise it is we've seen a few developments in the last 5 years where access has been created as a result of a home burning down and the lot being sold, or I think Abaco Drive is another. Well, that may be different, but I believe that.
They purchase land, yeah.
So
we understand there's a
will. I'm not advocating that people start restrictions on their deeds, but I don't have an issue with, or I don't have a concern with this particular issue myself for this particular application, for the reasons that Peter stated and the applicant and our town attorney have stated. Are there any other questions or comments on this issue?
All right, thank you very much.
John, what do you want to cover next?
The final thing that we want to cover is included in Exhibit 3, or Section 3 of our booklet. It's my letter dated December 30th, 2005, and basically what it does is to identify some of the issues, topics that were brought out at the public hearing, and this is our response. So I'd like to just quickly go through the ones that we haven't already discussed. Beginning with wetlands, we have included as Exhibit 5, if you turn to 5, you'll see a 11 by 17 fold-out, which is a copy, a reduced copy of a previous wetland study that was submitted on this property by another company. And if you look at this wetland plan and compare it to our wetland delineation, it's very similar. And actually, this is a plan of that graphic. It's very similar. In fact, Dale Brewer, our wetland specialist, has actually delineated more wetland on our plan. But this is just to illustrate that the two wetland delineations are very similar. In addition to that, Dale Brewer invited David Roque out to the site. David Roque is the main soil scientist in the state of Maine. He is a very well-respected individual wetland scientist among the wetland specialists. He was instrumental in the current wetland regulations. He actually helped to create the wetland manuals. And he's the only one, according to Dale, that within the state agencies that in the Army Corps that actually go out and review wetland delineations. David visited the site and reviewed Dale's wetland delineation and responded with this email, which you have in your packet. And I'll just read, "It is my professional opinion that you have appropriately identified and delineated all wetlands on the property." He goes on to say that, "And with respect to the vernal pools, I do not believe either of the ponds would qualify." So I think, you know, with our hope is that we put this to rest tonight, that the wetland delineation is has been reviewed and has actually been peer-reviewed by David Roque, and he concurs. Under the alternative subdivision designs, during our initial design of this...
If I could just jump in.
Sure.
Are you leaving the issue of wetlands now? Then I'm just wondering if
I'm sorry.
Appropriate for the board to
yes.
jump in now and
yes,
ask
it is.
Questions if there are any. Was Mr. Roque our... Did we hire him to
no,
do the peer review?
No, we did not. My understanding is that Mr. Brewer contacted him and he, quote, had some free time. This time of year, he's not as busy as other times of the year.
Okay.
But is that true, Mr. Mitchell?
It is. It is.
So
yeah.
It's a sort of a peer review that you all arranged on your own. I mean, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with that.
No.
But I just wanna, when you say peer review, it kind of connotes that there was town involvement.
Dale invited David when he first, or when he just completed his wetland delineation, and it's taken all this time for David to schedule that site visit. Dale knew that, you know, this was going to be a very sensitive subject, and therefore he invited David to review his work.
John?
Yeah, we met David, I think, on January 4th. He happened to be coming out of the woods and helped explain what he was looking for. And he did make it clear that you can't see eggs and salamanders and the other creatures that you're looking for on January 1st, 4th, in the middle of the winter. So I wouldn't even call it a peer review if you can't see those things in the middle of the winter, as far as the vernal pools go.
That's true. However, David indicated in his email neither wetland area, and he's referring to the two ponded areas, appears to have ponded water for a long enough period of time based on the extent of water stained leaves in trees growing in temporary ponded areas.
Barbara?
Judge, I was there also, and he said if the planning board deems that they want him to, that he would come back at our behest, and there is no charge to anybody because he works for the state. If that's not really a consideration, but it's nice to know. But if we have any questions down the line, he would be happy to come back and review for us.
I'm just trying to get a handle on the timing, John. When April rolls around, for example, I'm wondering where, or maybe this is a question for Maureen, would that be a time of year where there would be an opportunity for some evaluation of the vernal pools or not, or is it still too early in the season? I know we can't probably, by the terms of our ordinance, hold you up.
That's the kicker.
But if we're not doing final, if we get to final subdivision review, when that would occur no earlier than our April public meeting, correct?
I really can't, I mean, believe me, many people have asked the question of when this is going to happen, and I mean, it's whenever the board votes. Mm-hmm. I don't know when you're going to vote. I do know the applicants would like you to vote tonight. This is, that won't be happening. Certainly, if the application is still in the review process at a point in time where wetlands analysis can be done again, you could ask the applicant to do that. My guess is the applicant's going to tell you fairly quickly that, you know, that could dramatically alter their site design, and they'd like an answer sooner rather than later. But we've had wetland experts go out in the middle of the winter. Wetland ordinance has been in effect since May of 1990, and for 15 years, we've had two wetland boundaries revised in all that time. So I feel, my experience has been that usually they're not that wrong. But certainly, I guess, if the board is really committed to having it done in the spring, you know, you can just wait and see where this project is when spring comes.
But didn't David say that you really couldn't do the final definitive analysis until doing a springtime?
Yes, but the other thing he said was, it's not just, if you don't have the right soils and you don't have the right amount of water, you know you're not going to have eggs. And what he was saying is, he came out of the woods, with a spade in his hand, and blood on his boots, and he dug in the soil, and as John read in the email, the areas that had water weren't even areas that he was considering wetlands. And that based on what he could see of the leaf litter and what he could dig up of the soil, it didn't even begin to hit the criteria for the type of soil and the type of hydrology that would support a vernal pool. But, and I'm
comfortable with the, I was just trying to make a point that this was not really a peer review because it was the middle of January and you couldn't see eggs, but I think in my opinion, the wetlands have been outlined by Dave's, or by Dale's.
It should also be clear that during this chance meeting, there was no discussion of this project.
That's correct.
There were some generic questions about what kind of soil you find in a wetland and what kind of soil you find with vegetation. And the answer in the email was related specifically to the project, but there was no discussion specifically of what was going on and what he had done in the woods.
I do not distrust Dale, nor do I distrust what David said, but because this has been a controversial element in this proposal, I felt like if it fit into the schedule we were going to be running on, having another analysis done in April would be a good idea. I don't think, I recommend we hold things up for that, but if it works into the schedule, I think it would be a good idea to do it.
Leave it open. I mean, it's not, we're not foreclosed from doing that. It's appropriate to bring the point up so that we're not surprised when you ask Jack in April. Fair enough.
I agree with that general approach. It's probably not all that helpful to the applicant, but I don't think we can hold you up, but it may be that a final meeting on the subdivision approval may not occur till May anyway. We just don't know how this is going to pan out in the next few months. We know that we're not going to talk about traffic tonight.
Right.
That brings us till February 27th. Anyway.
Okay.
Any other questions on wetlands? Okay.
Okay. Under subdivision design, the first bullet, alternative subdivision designs. During the initial design of this project, we prepared several alternatives, alternative designs, one of which was the conventional subdivision plan layout. And if you refer to Exhibit 7, we've included a copy of our plan, which shows the conventional 20,000 square foot minimum lot area subdivision. And the board requested that we provide a copy of this. Just to give you some land use data on this subdivision, obviously it's the same area, 25 acres. The number of lots, we would have been permitted 35 lots. We proposed 26 lots. The minimum lot size is 20,000 square feet. The total road length is 2,880 linear feet versus the 1,900 linear feet for our proposal. The total open space is 7.16 acres versus the 10.5 acres that we're proposing. And the total usable open space is 3.05 acres versus 5.9 acres that we're proposing. Obviously, there are no trails and no public access that was proposed for this. So, are there any questions on this?
Barbara.
I got lots of questions.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I did some calculating on this, and these are rough calculations, but I'd like to say there are things that I think we as a board need to consider. There's the intent of the law and the spirit of the law. And we can talk about open space. And some of this on this parcel is not what I consider open space. There are little tiny swatches all around the top. There's a piece on the, as I'm looking at it, the left-hand side of the lot on the top, which you have to cross a wetland if you're in any other lots to get to. There's a little tiny piece that goes out to Route 70, or to Spurwink Road, that you'd have to cross an RP1 wetland to get to. And those totals, and I believe my figures are accurate because I've taken them off here, equal 90,176 square feet, or 2.07 acres, of what I would consider to be either not open space or marginal open space. And if you subtract that from what you're using as total open space, the difference between, and I never saw this design prior to, neither did any of us, prior to tonight. And I know there's a lot of talk about clustered housing and open space developments. And I think in concept, it's a great idea. But concept and actuality don't always work out the same way. And in terms, and I'm being very honest about, I think we need to sometimes put all our cards on the table. This subdivision is going to remove almost all the trees. The lots are tiny. There's no way you can preserve them. The other subdivision with the 26 lots on them, there aren't any trails, it's true, but the trees, some of them could be preserved in that model. Now, maybe that's not the best model. I haven't had a chance to really look at it, except on this sheet. But if you have a 20,000-square-foot lot, you can build a house on 11,000 square feet of it and leave 9,000 square feet, and you can build a 2,500 or 3,000-square-foot house on that and still have leave some of these trees. You'd have to show me how any trees are going to be left in most of this subdivision.
Okay.
Go ahead. In terms of the open space, if you could talk about that first, because I'm only coming up with an acre of usable open space.
In terms of the open space, which is the next bullet, let me just review with the board one more time. With the 25 acres, we're required to create 10 acres of open space. That's 40% under the open space provisions. We are proposing 10.5 acres. Under the usable open space, which is what you're referring to, we are required to create 3.3 acres, or a third of the 10 acres, right?
No, I understand all the numbers.
And we're proposing 5.9 acres. Now, I know you differ. I know you have some issues with what is considered usable. But what I prepared this graphic to illustrate the actual minimum required amount of usable open space. And it is this contiguous piece of open space which calculates to 3.3 acres. That's deducting all of this peripheral area that we have categorized as open space. And this is just to illustrate that we have met the requirement under the open space zoning provisions of the 3.3 acres, or a third of the 10 acres.
So, John, if I understand this correctly, then you're omitting from the 3.3 acres strip along the top part of the plan.
We're omitting all of the other periphery usable open space, which serves as, I mean, there are some areas that serve as a buffer, there are some areas that serve as a trail, but this is to show you that we have met the ordinance.
So that, because that isn't on here, so it says total open space,
no.
But...
I knew this was going to come up tonight, so I prepared this graphic. And the other thing I want to mention is that, you know, all the way from the workshop, all the way through, we've been talking about open space zoning. And we have received the direction from the board to go in that direction. So it...
I know that. Unfortunately, sometimes when you get more and more into projects and you see more and more things, and so maybe initially you don't ask all the right questions or say the right things.
In the conventional subdivision, there would be no restriction for any individual lot owner to go in and clear cut his lot. And on that, there's very little usable open space. We have the layout of Spermick Woods. I do want to mention this again also. It was designed in a manner to preserve the critical and more sensitive areas of the property. And I think you saw this during the site visit. This red indicates the proposed road, which goes through none of the wetlands, and it avoids 95% of the ledge outcrops. It puts all of the RP1, all of the RP2, or most of the RP2, it puts the significant ledge outcrops, which occur in this area here, the steep slopes, in the wetlands. The buildable areas of this property are this area, this portion here, and this portion over here. So I want to convey to the board that it was getting to know the site and designing this project with respect to the more sensitive, critical areas of the property. The Conservation Commission has reviewed this and approved it unanimously. And as you know, the intention of the applicant is to dedicate this open space to the town.
I have a question about that, too. Is there going to be a restriction in the deed that that land could never be sold? Because there were some questions about another piece of land that the town had, that there was a fight over at the council.
Absolutely. It will.
Okay.
Are there any other questions or comments on the open? John, are you finished on the open space?
I am.
But does any members of the board have any questions or comments on that? One of the reasons why, I think it might have been me, who asked to see one of the earlier versions of the plan was, at least in my opinion, the proposal that's now before us is far superior than a plan that would preserve virtually no buffer between Spurwink Woods, the new neighborhood, and the existing neighborhoods, and also have a lot less open space. So I'm not sure I'd be inclined to have you change directions at this point. And I'm taking the temperature of the board. I'm assuming that that's the general consensus. I know Barbara has some more misgivings now.
Well, it's just the density. I like open space, but it's the density of this project. It's very dense, and it's going to remove all the woods.
Right. So if we were to push the applicant in the other direction, all of those individual lot owners could remove all the woods, too. And we'd have very little control over the issues of buffering and preserving more open space.
We
agree. Any other comments?
It's very subjective. I mean, I agree with what you've said, David, but I think that it's likely that the alternative development would have left more of the original trees. You might have had less need to plant new trees. Would have left more of the original trees, which has some desirable aspects to it. But I agree with what you said, that I think overall the new development is a superior approach to use of the land.
We should move on to the next issue.
South Street stream crossing, we've talked about. As I mentioned, we are proposing a retaining wall in this area here, where it's very tight to the property line, and a guide rail along the top of the retaining wall. The vegetated buffer on South Street, we also have talked about. We're proposing some evergreen plantings here to supplement the existing vegetation.
I had a question about
yes.
vegetative buffer. And it goes, and someone can correct me if I'm wrong, in 16.3.1c, is there not some provision for, and maybe it's included in some of your drawings, but I didn't see it, a vegetative buffer around the external border of the property? Because I noticed the new maps or drawings had this buffer there on South Street, but nowhere else against other joint abutting lots. And I thought, is there not a provision that says that the outside border should have?
I'm not aware of that. I mean, we are preserving existing vegetation.
Okay, that area.
In that area. In this particular area where the road comes in close proximity to the property line, we're supplementing it with 11 Canadian hemlocks.
Yep. Maybe it's if the trees come down or the... Yeah, maybe if the trees have come down, then more plantings have to be done around the exterior. Am I right? 16?
Are you talking about the curve of South Street? What area?
No, I'm talking about around the whole border. 16.3. Okay. Where's 16.3.1? Here.
Yeah, the town planner has actually located the section you're talking about.
You're right. The standard does say that plants or other types of vegetative cover shall be preserved or placed throughout and around the perimeter of any proposed subdivision to provide for an adequate buffer, a reduction of noise and lights, separation between the subdivision abutting properties, and enhancement of its appearance.
So if the existing vegetation is still there,
right.
I don't know. Maybe it does allow provision for enhancement, but maybe it's something that can be considered if it looks like it's not.
Not much room in part of it.
Yeah, yeah. Yep.
We fully intend to preserve the existing vegetation within those areas.
John, how many feet are it?
20 feet.
Any other comments on that issue?
Trail system. We also talked about this. We have relocated portions of the existing trail along this property line here to create additional distance between the condominiums and the trail. It's a very extensive trail system that meanders throughout the project, connecting to public roads. It connects to existing trails, and it connects to town-owned property. And it's open for the public. Stormwater, I'm sorry.
Excuse me.
Yes.
There was I just want to refer to the comment by one of the people at the last planning board meeting that trails were coming within 13 feet of condominiums. Now you've enlarged that. You know what the minimum distance is now?
45 feet.
45 feet, thank you.
Yes.
Any other questions on the trail system? Okay.
Stormwater, Al has reviewed that with you. Extension of South Street, I'm not sure why I put that, but we are maintaining this extension of South Street to the adjacent property as requested. Subdivision dead end roads, under Exhibit 8, we have provided 2 8.5 by 11 exhibits, one of the Hamlin Street subdivision to illustrate the number of dwelling units and where that limit is, as well as the Mitchell Highlands subdivision to show you where the 20 dwelling units extend from Mitchell Road. The point of this was to show the board that both of these subdivisions are not in compliance with the current zoning ordinance, and that Springwick Woods will bring these subdivisions into compliance with the connectivity that we're providing. In addition to this, and aside from the fact that we're following the ordinance when we make these connections, you have also, I believe, received two correspondence, one from Michael McGovern, memo dated December 23rd, 2005, with 48 pages of backup correspondence going back 38 years, demonstrating the need and desire for connectivity and public safety. The second correspondence you received is from Chief McGoldrick, dated January 3rd, 2006, also supporting the Springwick Woods traffic flow and connectivity in terms of public safety.
And we'll focus almost exclusively on that issue at the public
yes.
meeting on February 27th?
Yes, okay. We will. And my final comment or a final item here is under construction. There were some questions regarding blasting. And under Exhibit 9, we have included a specification for blasting that will be included in the contract documents for this project. And if you have any questions regarding blasting, we've got Skip Murray here.
Jack, did you have a question yes. on that issue?
Yeah, I do, actually. Is there a plan to do video recordings of the foundations of all the abutting homes?
Yes, I'm Skip Murray. We will do a pre-blast survey of all homes within 500-600 feet, or if people even further away than that would like that done.
Video.
It'll all be done independently as of right in this moment in time. SW Coal Engineering does all my pre-blast surveys, and it'll all be private record in there.
Okay,
office.
Barbara?
Well, there was just, there was something in here about notifying Spurwink Woods, but nothing about notifying the owners of the surrounding houses, but I guess you'll have to, if you're going to...
All structures within a minimum distance of 500 feet.
500 feet, yeah.
Yeah.
But there was something else in here. It's fine.
So those are there any other questions regarding blasting? Those are the items that I highlighted. You may have more that we'd be glad to discuss. But that concludes our presentation.
All right, thank you. On the issues that we have covered tonight, are there any other questions or comments?
I'd really like to commend you for increasing the separation from 13 feet to 45 feet. I think that makes the trails much more usable.
Right. Thank you.
John didn't cover all of the issues that were outlined in the town planner's memo, and that's fine, but are there any of those issues that any of the planning board members would like to hit on tonight? I think some of them are sort of interrelated. I don't want to foreclose that discussion.
Well, one of them is density, but that's such a...
I know it meets
yep. the subdivision requirement law and open space zoning, but there have been many, many comments from abutters about density, and it's something we really haven't discussed.
And you're talking about 46 units?
No, I'm talking about the 42 units. I know they could go 46. I mean, I know what the law says. You don't have to do what the law says. But there have been lots of comments from abutters about the density of the project, and it's not something we've discussed at all. Maybe something nobody wants to discuss at all.
Well, I think clearly the abutters want to see fewer units going in there, but I'm not aware of any way we could restrict the applicant to fewer units if we're going to pursue this type of zoning. What I hear you saying is you'd express the hope that the applicant would consider fewer units, or?
Oh, I'd love to consider fewer units.
So are there any other?
Well, I mean, I just want to make one point that we have, you all know that we're allowed 46. We're proposing 42. And we've followed the open space zoning ordinance. We've worked hard with town staff. This is in compliance with the adopted comprehensive plan. And, we're trying to follow the ordinance.
John?
Yeah. Do you have something?
No.
It goes back to this perimeter and the fact, I think you've moved the trail out around the perimeter.
Yes.
The fact that the condominiums are fairly, what's the distance between the condominiums and the perimeter in most of the, it's about 50 feet?
It's in the perimeter property line?
Yeah.
Yeah, 50 plus feet.
So yes. If, in my experience, in where buildings are being, residences are being constructed, it's very hard to leave trees that between the structure and the edge of the property 40 feet, most of that time that is cleared. If that's correct. The case, then should we not ask the applicant to follow 6.3.1 and ensure that there are additional trees? Because I don't think it shows up on your plan that there are trees around the perimeter
actually,
to protect
John,
the abutters.
It does. This tree line is inaccurate.
Okay.
Okay, in the one area where it doesn't, where we aren't preserving trees along the property line is behind units 11 and 12. That area we can supplement with proposed trees.
Okay, maybe I was looking at the wrong drawing that had the trees.
But if you look on the grading plan
on our
set of drawings, that is an accurate representation of the tree line.
John, is there a reason, is it unit 11, that the backyard, if you will, wouldn't have the buffer? Is there a way that could be reconfigured to create a buffer? The reason for the layout there?
The only thing that we could do is to steepen up the grades in that area.
to, I think we have a 3-to-1 slope now, and we could steepen them up to 2-to-1 and possibly save some trees there. We'll look at that. Yep.
Paul?
Two questions to Maureen on her memo to us. One regarding property values, and the other one regarding general construction. Maureen, has there ever been a add-on to an existing dead-end subdivision in the town of Cape Elizabeth? Okay.
Well, I mean, I don't know if you want to count it, but I did pull the Mitchell Highland subdivision, and it was actually approved in three separate parts.
Okay.
So the first part in 1965 had 10 or 11 lots, and then there was a middle piece, and then there was an end piece. So technically, that's an add-on to the dead-end.
Would a Cove View and Heritage Court?
Yes. Cove View and Heritage Court would be an add-on to a dead end, yes.
That's in Broad Cove.
That's a good point.
Okay. So again, that's all.
And Channel View Road, another one.
Has any of those ever changed the dead end to a thruway?
Not that one.
Jordan Farm Road did, but it's an emergency access.
It's only emergency, right.
That's right.
So do we have any history of changing a dead end to a through road?
Belfield Road?
That's an emergency access.
My guess is that some of Brentwood started out like that and got connected up, but I have to pull the old Brentwood plans. Brentwood is a through subdivision. You can get from Route 77 to Scott Dyer Road by driving through Brentwood. But I don't hear any complaints from them that happens.
I think that was the thrust of John Seraldo's comments. That was a question, really.
But again, my question was relative just to the discussion. I'm assuming that's looked at everything relative, and that's where the basis of the comment is from.
I can put more thought into it to see if I can come up with some other examples for you.
That'd be great. My second question is, has the board ever required the applicant to have a greater limitation on the time in which construction can occur, to your knowledge?
I can't think of a time when we would have done that. Okay. I think we have some very explicit, and Mr. Murray's quite familiar with this, explicit restrictions on what you can do in an earth materials operation when there is blasting.
Yep.
But I believe that even those restrictions tend to mirror the construction restrictions.
They do, yeah. I was just curious if the board had ever done that, yet you're aware of.
No, we tend to stay it has been my advice to the board in the past that where the authority for an activity rests elsewhere than with the board, that the board focus on its own actions and leave those other activities to those other groups.
Okay.
Review of HHE 200 forms is another one of those areas. We don't regulate parking on roads. That's the purview of the council through the roads ordinance. I don't remember when we've done that.
Okay. Answer my question. Thank you.
Did you have any other questions of us at this point? It seems to me we've gone through the issues that we intended to review tonight in our draft memo. The suggestion was made to table this until February meeting, because we're at that point we'll have all that we need, hopefully, to discuss the issue of traffic. Go ahead.
I know at the February 27th meeting you were intending to talk about traffic, and the town's traffic engineer, Tom Errico, has been asked to be there. I'm assuming that the applicant's traffic engineer would be there. The fire chief has also asked me if it would be useful for him to be there as well.
Maureen, will the town traffic engineer come prepared with suggestions for the abutting neighbors? Because we've had them sort of generally, but You know, these are things that at the very least we can require them to do prior to doing anything with the subdivision.
I can ask our engineer to come in. Are you talking about actually?
Traffic calming.
I know, but I mean, there's like a shopping list of things that you can do.
Well, recommendations of the things he thinks are the most important.
Rank them.
Most important, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, just to give us a general sense of.
Yes.
If he were picking three or five, or in what order would he do the following suggested changes? And it doesn't have to be etched in stone, but it's just a stone.
For both sides.
Right.
Hamlin and Stevenson and the Mitchell Road in Columbus and all kinds of.
I also had another request for next meeting when we talk about traffic. If it were possible for someone to have a larger bird's eye view of the area so that you can see the mall and see Portland, because it's very hard to get a sense in my mind of, and I think the gentleman that spoke about traffic had a tough time understanding how to calculate cut-through traffic. And it just seemed if you had a bigger, like a larger picture, then it would be easier to have a better sense of how traffic would move. I mean, he didn't seem to have any other better idea about how he was going to calculate. So I don't know if that's the applicant or our traffic people, something that is a little bit.
I think that makes sense. And maybe, Maureen, you could work with our peer review traffic engineer and try to come up with something. Then is there a motion at this point that someone's willing to make? Peter?
I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented and the pending issues and items to be submitted by the application of Spurwink Woods LLC for preliminary subdivision review, resource protection permit for Spurwink Woods, and the pending application for a modification or amendment to the Mitchell Highland subdivision located between Dermot Drive and Killdeer Road be tabled to the regular February 27, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board.
Motion has been made.
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries. Thank you for your presentation tonight.
I assume we're keeping the 27th, is that what we decided?
Yes. That is all of the issues on our agenda tonight. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Don't we have one other thing? Don't we have to talk about make a motion to maintain the chair and the.
Oh.
Not like that.
Why don't we?
Do we have to get that on tape or something? But I don't know how to do that. I don't know.
I'd like to propose a motion.
Okay. Hi, excuse me. Hi.
Excuse me. We actually do have a little bit more business we have to conclude. Excuse me. We just have some housekeeping issues here. You're welcome to stick around and ask questions when we're done, but we just got to get through it. John, our newest member, has reminded us all that we do have the issue of election of officers for the coming year, so I'm glad that at least one of us is on the ball. So we need nominations for a chair and vice chair for the 2006 calendar year. Peter.
I nominate David Sherman for chair and Barbara Schenker for vice chair.
Second.
And do you accept the nomination as vice chair, Barbara? No? It's been made and seconded to retain you as vice chair and me as chair. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Can we vote? The motion carries. Any other business?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second. All those in favor? Public meeting is concluded. Thank you.
Thank you.